The jungle warfare against huge communist forces in Vietnam was a deadly and unique challenge to our United States forces. The limited American forces faced an unlimited number of communist forces who also had the incomparable advantage of a sanctuary for their replacements beyond the 18th parallel. The U.S. government granted this sanctuary, fearing that any military action beyond it would cause reprisals by Communist China. In South Vietnam, our troops could not distinguish enemy from friendly Vietnamese. A village could be friendly by day and enemy by night. It was a battlefield with no boundaries. A secret supply route in nearby Laos funneled a constant arms supply to the enemy. The jungle provided perfect cover for the enemy, constantly posing ambushes from the rear and flanks of our troops. Bayonet and gun butt, hand-to-hand fighting was frequent. Capture by the enemy could mean torture in a communist prison camp. The constant unbearable heat with high humidity enervated our troops. The unstable South Vietnamese political situation crippled their war efforts. Bitterly opposed political factions caused the assassination of President Diem by a military coup whose leaders then could not unify the country. Meanwhile, in the U.S., the drumbeat of communist propaganda split the citizens of the U.S., especially our youth. Despite all these odds, the U.S. forces had practically knocked out the communist forces in South Vietnam by mid-1966, when new and highly trained North Vietnamese communist forces poured into South Vietnam. Such was the daunting situation faced by our troops when Father Vincent Capodanno arrived as a chaplain for a regiment of our Marines. Chaplain Vincent Capodanno, at whose statue we're standing here in Staten Island, New York, treasured the strange title given to him by his admiring fellow Marines, the Grunt Padre, an honored title among Marines in combat. He earned that title by his experience in severe combat in many places, but especially near a small town deep in the jungle of Vietnam on September the 4th, 1967, where about 400 Marines held off a force of trained communist veterans, five times their number. Father, ministering physically and spiritually to the many wounded and dying there, had his right hand practically shot off, then his right arm, but refusing aid, he continued his ministry to the wounded and to the dying and responded to the call of a wounded medic in an exposed position where help really could not get to him. Father crawled to the side of that medic, shielded him with his body, and then comforted him with the words, "Stay quiet, Marine. God is with us all this day." Instantly, his body was riddled by a burst of enemy machine gun fire. The United States government has awarded to Father, with its highest military decoration, the Congressional Medal of Honor. His fellow Marines have called him a saint. Hello, everybody. I'm Archbishop Philip M. Hannon, former chaplain, 82nd Airborne Division, World War II. And I have the honor of presenting to you the life of Chaplain Vincent Capodanno. Vincent Capodanno Jr. was born on February the 13th, 1929, in his family's home in Elm Park, Staten Island, New York.
There was nine of us, and Mom and Pop made 11, and then we had a dog, Johnny. Mom always had a big gang, and she cooked. She had the table filled with food.
Right.
Always. We weren't rich, but we had food, plenty of food to eat.
We developed the habit of going to Mass on William Street, Our Lady of Victory Parish, in the morning, and then having breakfast together in a wonderful restaurant nearby. Mm-hmm. And whenever I think of Vincent, I think of a hard-boiled egg, because his sister told me that all through grade school, he went to Mass as often as he could, and he had a hard-boiled egg in his pocket. Mm-hmm. In those days, you couldn't eat anything before communion.
When did you know that Father V wanted to go to be a priest?
Oh, well, I really didn't. None of us knew.
Is that right?
No, nobody knew.
He didn't talk
we
about
had,
those
My
things.
Brother Philip used to be an altar boy, and we always thought that he would go toward the priesthood, and Vincent would go with the being a medical doctor.
I see.
Because he had poor handwriting. And then he went to Fordham. He was working in New York, downtown New York, for an insurance company. And then he was going to Fordham at night. Mm-hmm. And I think that's when he decided he was going to be a priest.
Right.
When he was going to Fordham. But I didn't have any idea of it.
Uh-huh.
Vincent told me, he said, you know, I felt called to the priesthood in grade school, and I said no. And again in high school, and I said no. But he said, it's come back again, and I can't say no anymore. I have to think about it and go.
Vincent entered the Mary Knowles Seminary on June the 25th, 1949.
I was honored that he went.
Fine.
And
everybody
became everybody
supported
sure,
him in the family.
Sure, everybody did. Mom was a little surprised, you know, because she felt like, in those times, she felt like you're losing a son, you know.
Right, sure.
But she went right along with it after that.
He said, Bill, why don't you think about this? I think you have a vocation. Well, frankly, that was the farthest thing from my mind at the time. You know, I was working, had a good job and all the rest. So, I don't know, he put the bug in my ear. So we ended up going into Mary Knoll in August of 1949.
He shall triumph, he shall triumph. Vincent Capodanno was ordained in June 1958.
He was one of the 48 who was ordained.
Yes.
Together with you.
Yeah. We were ordained by Cardinal Spellman, the Archbishop Cardinal of New York Archdiocese, and had a close association with Mary Knoll. It was just a very beautiful June day, and it was a very nice day. We had just got our mission assignments about 6 weeks before that, and he was assigned over to Taiwan.
On August the 4th, 1958, Father Vincent Capodanno was sent to Formosa, Taiwan, as a Mary Knoll missionary.
I would write to him when he was in Taiwan, and I remember very well he wrote back, and he said that his mission station was next to a Buddhist temple, and the Buddhists had many funerals all day long, and they played music at the funerals. Mm-hmm. And one of their favorite songs was, I Wonder Who's Kissing Her Now. They didn't know the words, but they liked the tune, and they'd play it as a dirge.
It would have been my fifth year in Taiwan, and Father Vince's second year. He had had a year of language study in Miaoli, the county seat nearby, and his second year assigned to a veteran Hakka-speaking missioner, Father Maynard Murphy, who was pastor of Tung Lo.
After 6 years of service in Taiwan, Father Vincent was forced to make a drastic change in his life.
But he was assigned from Taiwan to come to Hong Kong to teach English in some of the high schools there. Well, we were surprised that he was assigned to Hong Kong because originally he was assigned to Taiwan and had learned Hakka. The language in Hong Kong is Cantonese. He was not very happy about that assignment because I don't think he was consulted about it, and he was just assigned out. And the one thing we do have is kind of obedience.
Sure.
So he came. But I don't think he was very happy about the assignment.
Looking for a different challenge, Father Capodanno requested a new assignment as a Navy chaplain serving with the U.S. Marines. He specifically requested to serve the soldiers in Vietnam. On August the 13th, 1965, Bishop Comber finally consented to Father Vincent's repeated requests and gave him permission to begin the process of military induction. At last, paperwork and training behind him, Father Vincent reached his goal. During Holy Week of April 1966, he stepped onto the soil of Vietnam, where he would serve as a chaplain for the 7th Regiment, 1st Marine Division.
Did it surprise you when you learned that he had become a chaplain in combat and that he actually was very devoted to these, to the men?
It surprised me in the sense that it was a completely different type of work than Marine Corps are usually involved in. It didn't surprise me in this sense that I know he wanted something that he could get into and really give himself to completely. So he saw this opportunity or this call, and he responded. Yeah.
So when I heard about him in Vietnam, I was not surprised, you know, that he was a hero. He was a person that one could depend upon and who would follow through. He was a good, solid person that way.
He really felt that he was being, well used, if you want, right. You know. And he found some place where he could really give himself as a priest, as a minister, in working with these young men in the service.
And I felt that that was his dedicated life as a priest.
When I first arrived in Vietnam, I heard the chaplain say, Capodanno this, Capodanno that, what a great man he was. And I conjured in my mind this great, big, gregarious Italian, a backslapper, loud, and mixes with the troops and all that. And so that's what I had pictured in my mind. And as I approached, I saw this gaunt-looking man who was all bones and muscle, wiry, and he raised this chalice above his head. And he was so graceful, I thought, my goodness, this is like a ballet. He did it with such intensity and such grace that it had to emanate from his heart.
I once thought, watching him at Mass, that he was like the Pied Piper in just attracting everybody to Mass. And everybody, regardless of their faith, as he performed general absolution, was making the sign of the cross. It was a most remarkable situation. And his homily was just designed to reach the Marines at a very, very basic level.
He didn't look down on them, and he didn't lecture them. He supported them. He was there for their spiritual well-being, not to be a nanny or a proctor, but to support their spiritual needs, and they understood that. And
you know, he's an intelligent man. He was well educated, but he talked to them and with hands in the pocket, and that in their language that they could understand, and they knew they were talking to, if not an equal, a friend. Mm-hmm. Somebody that they could depend on, somebody that they can relate to.
Well, let me ask you this. You're not a Catholic, and he seemed to be acceptable to everybody. Is that right?
He was absolutely ecumenical. Father Capodanno provided an awful lot of spiritual succor for whatever denomination you might be.
When he would say Mass, it was not uncommon to have the local women with their rice conical hats, black pajamas, babies strapped on their back. A lot of them were Catholic. Most of them were Buddhist. A lot of them were Catholic. They would come, stand around the back, wait for Mass to go. And then after Mass, and everyone, you never knew who was a Catholic, who wasn't. It didn't make any difference. They all came because here's a man of God, shared a few thoughts. And after the Mass, people wouldn't leave. You know how we all leave church a little early sometimes?
Right.
They wouldn't leave. They'd stay. As long as Father would stay, they would stay.
It was my experience that there were certain priests who were just naturals to be chaplains. And I think that he achieved that peace because he finally found that this was his complete niche.
Archbishop, you're absolutely right. Mm-hmm. It was his world, it was his time, mm-hmm. and he couldn't have been happier. It exuberated from
That's
him.
That's right, yeah. Sure.
Although Father was delighted to fulfill every duty of a chaplain, there was a hitch to his serving in combat. His immediate commanding officer wanted him to be protected from the enemy in combat. The senior Catholic officer, Major Anthony Grimm, was assigned the task of providing that protection.
When he dubbed me the senior mackerel snapper, he did so, and the mackerel snapper is a common Marine Corps and Navy expression for Catholics.
That's right.
It's not disparaging
that's
in any
right.
way.
No, that's
but he did so when he assigned me responsibility for Father Capodanno, basically to make sure he stayed safe. In particular, to keep an eye on him and keep him from slipping out through the wire with patrols that went out, because he liked to accompany patrols. He liked to be with the troops. He wanted to accompany them in their dangerous situations, in their normal duties. I was also told that he would have an assistant assigned to him, which we commonly called a shotgun, because the assistant's job was to ride shotgun or be protection for him.
Right.
And Father Capodanno said, no way. Mm-hmm. He wasn't going to have anybody responsible for his life. He just couldn't accept that somebody might become a casualty because they were protecting him.
Was that a normal procedure there for...
To have a chaplain's assistant, it was.
It was?
Yes.
To protect the chaplain?
To protect the chaplain. But he liked to be independent, go mm-hmm. where he wanted to go, when he wanted to go, and not be under any restrictions. We discussed this over a period of about 2 days, and I said, all right, if you don't have a chaplain's assistant assigned to you, you're going to carry a weapon. Mm-hmm. You're going to carry a .45. And he got angry, and he got very angry with me, and he said, do you realize what you're asking me to do? I'm a Catholic priest. I can't carry a weapon. And I said, you've got a choice. It's either the .45 or a chaplain's assistant.
This, of course, is always a controversial subject. Most Navy chaplains that I knew never were armed, and he refused to carry an arm. He felt that he didn't need it, that it wouldn't convey the right message to the Marines if he was armed. And he never was armed with anything but the Bible and the wonderful words of encouragement.
Right. He never touched a weapon. He just walked mm-hmm. around and said his mass and met the troops and couldn't imagine him picking up a weapon.
Right.
It wasn't within him to do that.
Right.
Chaplain Capodanno knew that his true calling was not to carry a gun, but rather to give strength, comfort, and courage to his men by ministering to their medical and spiritual needs. He did so fearlessly, running straight into dangerous territory, going wherever his men needed him the most.
He always wanted to be with the unit that would be in the greatest danger.
That's true, yes.
How was he able to work that? Because it seems to me that he goes in and out of assignments. That is, he's assigned a battalion, but all of a sudden you find out that he's in another sector.
Well, he would always attend the briefings that we had before we had an operation. And we would, the S2 officer, the intelligence officer, would get up and make his briefing with the maps, and he would point out where he felt that the strongest resistance mm-hmm. would be felt by the Marines, and Father Capodanno could identify which company was going, mm-hmm. and all he had to do was go to the landing zone where those helicopters were going to land and just get on one of the helicopters. He pretty much had a free hand to go where he wanted to go when mm-hmm. he was in the field. Nobody told him that he shouldn't do this or that.
Came over the radio that we're trying to cross a stream, and the streams were swollen pretty heavy, and we were out there for 30 days. And they tried to get across the stream, and the only way they could do it was lock arms and get across the stream. Well, the chain of Marines broke. Two Marines got washed away. They weren't swimmers. They both drowned. And they were trying to recover the bodies, and it came over the radio, and I heard about it, and I saw the chaplain. I said, Bravo Company just lost a couple of kids trying to cross that creek up there. It's kind of swollen. And he said, where are they? I said, well, they're a couple of clicks away from here, clicks being kilometers. Mm-hmm. And he didn't even ask the colonel or anything. He just took off by himself out in the Badlands, and we were in the jungles, just went off by himself. And I didn't say anything to anybody. And how he found those Marines is he just had divine guidance to find them. But anyway, it was just like a shot out of a movie. Here comes Cappadano, leading the company. He's coming back in. And they got the two Marines up in the front, and they'd ripped the doors off of some hooches. Mm-hmm. And they were carrying them on, like, on their shields. There's six Marines carrying these two Marines dead on their shields, bringing them back in the battalion CP so we could evacuate them by helicopter. But that just one little act of him finding those Marines, giving them the last rites and bringing them back, and finding it, you know, all by himself, I just thought there must have been a trail that he was following or something. He had some type of guidance.
Shortly after I first met him, Father Cappadano slipped out on a platoon-sized patrol with me, which he was absolutely forbidden to do. He was so courageous and so committed to going out with the troops that the battalion commander, as I recall, had forbidden him to go out with anything other than the battalion headquarters, but it didn't make a bit of difference to Father Cappadano. He just would go anyway.
He moved from unit to unit. He did that in a way that was very unique. As he moved, and as he began to go from unit to unit, the troops would identify with him. And by the way, Father Mode's description of as the infantry grunt priest is absolutely perfect. He would move from company size to company size. Sometimes the men would just be coming out of the field or getting ready to go into the field, and we had operations going every day. There were men, new arrivals coming in, new replacements. Men were wounded, men died. So he lived in this world spread out as a man of one that would go from unit to unit, in a jeep or walk, whatever necessary to get there. But after the first or second time he'd been to that unit, and he tried to hit every one of them at least once a week, they would wait for him. He was ecumenical in every sense of the word. They became every Marine. Every Navy corpsman would be looking down the road to see when Father's coming. They'd say, hey, he's over at Charlie Company today. He'll be here this afternoon, and so forth. And so they waited for him.
How would he change from one unit to another? For instance, when he went on patrol with you, did he simply say to you, Lieutenant, I'd like to be with you, or was it simply taken for granted that he'd come along?
Well, he actually slipped out of the position we were in and followed by platoon on patrol until it was too late for us to tell him to go back, is how he did it with me. I don't know how he did it with the other folks, but he would just show up, and he had an aura about him I think that even the colonel was reluctant to argue with.
And he wouldn't ask permission at all.
He didn't to me. He just went.
Cappadano, in some ways, rallied the troops because they were kind of frozen initially. But he was the first one to move, apparently, at least this is what I'm told. And his movement was such that he went from man to man, and he encouraged them, and he would pray with them. And those who were wounded, of course, he'd pray with them and give them the blessing.
I was on a hilltop with there was a squad of us up there on a hilltop. We had a gun set in, and there was a helicopter pad, and he landed up there one day, and nobody ever came there. I mean, we'd get ammunition and stuff like that, but nothing else. And a chaplain, Father Vincent, jumped off the chopper. It was a surprise to see him there, and he came over and talked to me in particular. And I was shocked that a priest would go that far to see one person, even to come all the way there to see me.
Did it have the same effect on all of the men?
I would say it probably did, yeah. Now, there were certain people who won't listen, though. I mean, you've always got that. Sure. But I think nobody ever turned Father Vincent down. The men wanted him out there. We were afraid when he was out there, and we really didn't want him there, but he was a relief to see when things got bad.
Anybody, Your Excellency, that ever tells you they've never been afraid in combat, I'd like to meet them when you do on it, because I don't believe that. And they'll do their job. They are absolutely fearless in doing their job. But before and after comes a time, and a peaceful time, where you contemplate and you're afraid. And you're afraid of the next time it's going to happen. The first reaction is, I'm going to die. You know, it could be a flesh wound, and and any wound is serious, obviously. But it could not be a wound would maybe not be life-threatening, but they would be concerned about that. They would be worried about that. And he understood that, 10 minutes ago, maybe, this man was fighting and doing his job and doing it very well. And now he was a very, very young boy, hurt. And he wanted to share with them, and he wanted to show the compassion, and often wanted to bring the Lord to them. I believe that his previous tour of duty as a Marinole in China, in Taiwan, and in those villages helped set that mood, because he had done that for a number of years. He totally understood that the military presence was only one dimension of our being in Vietnam, and that we had to really care for the people. And that meant understanding them, and particularly understanding their culture.
In April of 1967, Father Vincent's first tour of duty was complete. He returned home, where he saw his family for the last time.
When he did go back, you say he had changed completely.
When I say changed, his whole body and mind was in Vietnam. He was here with us, but he was over there also.
I see.
And that's what I mean. He couldn't wait to get back. He didn't tell us, but you could see that. We understood that. Yeah.
And nobody tried to stop him.
No, no, no. Vincent had his own mind, and he was his own man.
I see.
And he, when he made his mind up, he did what he wanted to do.
Father Vincent knew his call was to serve the Marines in Vietnam. On June the 6th, 1967, his request for another tour of duty was granted. He returned to the work he truly loved, serving his fellow grunt Marines.
When we went around the lines, and I know this, he always had something for every, I don't know where he got all this stuff. He'd take a St. Christopher's medal or a bar of candy or something, and he'd leave every Marine, every fighting position with some little gift. And he did that, I don't know, almost every night that I can remember that we did. We walked the lines. And, well, when the chaplain was coming with us, I mean, he was in that battalion. He just made it a better battalion. I mean, the fighting spirit of my men was superb, and a lot of it was because of the fact that we had that chaplain there. Capodanno was the finest, greatest chaplain I ever met in my military career, and he was an inspiration to me and everybody else in the battalion.
On September the 4th, 1967, the 1st Battalion of the 5th Marines came under surprise attack from approximately 2,500 North Vietnamese. Capodanno was right there with them in the midst of danger. He would not have it any other way.
We were located on a hill called Hill 51 out in the Quezon Valley. We were surrounded by approximately 2,500 men of the 2nd NVA Division. They were in the hills around us, and we were fighting them every day for the time we were out there, which was probably in early June through September of 1967.
You were fighting them every day for those 3 months?
Yes, sir.
Good. Well,
7 days a week.
You had to have then a very strong discipline to keep the men going.
We for sure did. I was very tough on my officers, and the standards we held were really high. I did not consider one Marine expendable. Every night when we walked the lines, which was around 10 o'clock at night, we had to walk the entire perimeter. Capodanno would go along with us. And as an example of how it went, we'd go to a foxhole, and I'd usually ask the Marines, how's everything going? They'd say, fine, sir, and then we'd move on to the next foxhole, all right, and then I'd do the same thing. Well, we got to this one place, one fighting position, and it was a cave down just off the skyline or just off the ridge of our position, and I went down there, and there was a Marine in there, and we had a machine gun in there. And I said, how's it going, Marine? He said, not so good, sir. And I said, what's the problem? Mm-hmm. Well, I don't like this position, sir. So why don't you like it? He said, because when the enemy comes across this rice paddy out here, and it was a kind of a moonlit night, so you could see pretty well, he said, then bullets are going to come in here, fly all around, and I'm going to get killed. And I said, well, what are you going to be doing? Mm-hmm. He said, well, I'm going to be shooting them, sir. Mm-hmm. And I said, well, don't you think they'll be getting out of your way? Oh, yes, sir, they'll be shooting and killing them. And I said, fine, they're going to be so busy getting out of your way, they're not going to be having time to shoot you. And so this is a good position, and I like this position, and you're going to stay here. Well, I don't know if it settled him down or not, but that was what I said. And the next thing I knew is I came out, Capodanno was going down in there to talk to that Marine. We went on to the next foxhole, and I asked the Sergeant Major, I said, where's the chaplain? And he said, he's still back there talking with that Marine. And I said, well, I don't want him running around here loose, so we'll wait here till he catches up with us. And then a few minutes later, he caught up with us, and we went on around and completed the mission. I had one company out on patrol. Early in the wee hours of the morning, the enemy attacked them. I sent another company out to help them, and then it mushroomed into, it was going to be a battalion-sized affair. To me, that was a surprise. I did not anticipate that we were going to have to engage them with everything we had. And we knew we were surrounded in the Quezon Valley by all elements of the 2nd NVA Division. We fought them every day. But I believe that had brought in extra troops because of the elections that we were going to try to hold in that area.
And they wanted to disrupt the elections, was that it?
Correct.
I see.
So we had these companies out there screening the villages to protect them so they could have their elections. Mm-hmm. Since I didn't have any more companies left that I could commit, the regimental commander, Colonel Stanley Davis, made a decision to attach, and Dick Alger, his S3, made a decision to attach two rifle companies from the 3rd Battalion to me, K or Kilo, M or Mike Company. Those were the two companies. Mm-hmm. We were landed in two different landing zones when we went out there. My command group was landed with Kilo Company in one area, and then about 3,000 meters away from us, Mike Company was landed.
Now, there was always an argument about why he should be in such combat and who permitted it. For instance, he was not killed in actually the battalion to which he was assigned. He was in another battalion. And the argument always was, why was he in that battalion? And the officers themselves, I know their arguments, are arguing back and forth how he got there. What's your explanation?
Knowing the kind of guy that Father Vincent was, he saw a great need that day. That day we were really in heavy action. Mm-hmm. He knew that. So he came to where the need was greatest, and I don't think he needed anybody's permission to do that. Mm-hmm. You might say he answered to a higher calling.
But look, he got to where he was going by being in a helicopter.
Right.
Aren't you supposed to have permission to be in that helicopter?
Nobody's going to stop a Catholic priest from getting on a chopper.
Is that right?
Nobody. Uh-huh. I certainly wouldn't, and I'm sure the pilot didn't either.
And apparently Capodanno had somehow obtained permission to be on this operation, and he had joined the rear elements of M Company as they were getting on the plane. And so when and he was with the two lieutenants that were in the charge of the third platoon of that of his company and the weapons company, so that was where he was.
His sergeant of his own battalion said he asked permission, and he turned him down.
Right.
And he just turned away, and apparently went someplace else that was more hospitable to him, and that's how he did it.
I wouldn't be surprised if that's mm-hmm. true. I'd have a hard time as an officer saying no to a Catholic priest, chaplain, who wanted to go to field.
But as a commanding officer, would you have approved his being in fire like that?
No. I would have had a rope around. If he was coming with me, I'd have put a rope around his neck and tied him to my belt. Mm-hmm. I mean, I knew he was the kind of guy who wasn't gonna stay in one place. He was a grunt padre. He was gonna be with the men, and no matter what. So he would have either been left behind or he would have been chained to me. That's the only two ways he would have gotten out there. We were moving down this trail toward a village, and we'd been in. I recognized the area, and I knew we'd been in this village area before. And I knew the village had trenches all the way around it. But we saw the. I had scouts out. There were scouts out on either side of the column. One of them came running into me on the right side, and we had about 350 troops in this little group that I was with, these two companies, and maybe a little more, but not 350, 400 troops. And we were going to be outnumbered, so I put the lead company, which was K Company, in a V, mm-hmm. and then I brought M Company up online, and I told the company commanders to fix bayonets. We were outnumbered. We were going in there, and I want them to yell like hell and charge on my command, which is exactly what they did. And the fighting was with bayonets and rifle butts all across the area. M Company apparently hit the biggest concentration of the enemy, but it was very, very hot in the K Company area too. And I went in behind K Company. We did get in the trenches that were over there, and M Company was out there with their first and second platoons up forward, and then their third platoon was a little bit back. And Capodanno was apparently, after talking with Lieutenant Murray, told me that Capodanno was with the third platoon, and they had a radio. The platoon commander's he was with the platoon commander, so he could hear all the radio conversations. Mm-hmm. The second platoon was really getting bloodied, and they were across the field, and Capodanno ran out of there across this field, and John joined up with the second platoon and began administering first aid and last rites to those men who needed them, and then he was killed.
After they dropped the gas is when we started consolidating up the hill and we're moving up to take our positions with the rest of the company, with first and second platoons. I just remember I had a Vietnamese Marine that I was working with that was with me, and I was sort of assigned to watch after him also. But we were together at a point as we were moving up the hill, and it became fairly intense, and I just remember people yelling that we were being overrun at the time. And I'm not sure even what the father's words were, but I was scared. I know I was scared. I was sort of dug in and, you know, clinging to the ground, and so was the Vietnamese Marine that was with me. And, you know, I'm not sure exactly what he said, but it was just to calm me down and to get me to sort of, I don't know, relax, but just to not be as afraid. Everyone was screaming. People were screaming. People were dying. Mm-hmm. We were being overrun. It said, they shoot at anything that moves, because the NVA were well camouflaged all the time. We were getting close in air support. We had, we had I forget what the nomenclature is, but the Navy jets were coming in on night runs and dropping 250-pound bombs. So it was, I don't think any of us expected to make it through the night.
And soon Sergeant Peters come across, come from around the hill and come up to our squad and told us to get ready that 1st Platoon of Mike Company had been ambushed. So as we started around the right-hand side, the top of that little knoll, a lot of fire hit us. I believe machine gun opened up, and a lot of us hit the ground, and Sergeant Peters was out in front of us, and he'd been hit. I believe it was in the leg. And he hollered, he was hollering, he was firing at a large clump of bushes out to our front. And it was me and two other Marines that were closest to him. And he hollered, Harton, get that gun, and he was pointing his rifle at that clump of bushes. Well, it wasn't that far away, but it was too far away to throw in a hand grenade, so we, myself and these two other Marines, decided to get closer, and I had a hand grenade bag. Mm-hmm. And as we stood up to get closer, that machine gun opened up on us and killed PFC Fisher and Lance Corporal Santos, who were to my right and to my left. And a bullet hit me in the left forearm, and one hit my rifle. And it knocked me down on the ground, and of course the first thing you try to do is seek help. And I can remember screaming for a corpsman or screaming for someone to help me as the blood was just pumping out of my arm. I'm not sure how long it was. I can remember going, it seemed to me, in and out of consciousness. I knew I was losing blood, and every time I'd move, that machine gun would shoot at me. Mm-hmm. At some point that evening, I can remember seeing Doc Leal running towards me, and he was jumping back and forth between some other wounded or wounded guys. And the feeling I got then all of a sudden was, as I looked around, there were more North Vietnamese. They were all over the place. They were positioning on us. All I could see were the dead and Doc Leal, and I had felt myself passing out, mm-hmm. growing very weak. And I knew soon it was either going to be a bullet or a bayonet. I'd made peace with myself. And I can remember praying that it would be easy on my mother when she got the word. I'd more or less prepared to die. But I remember closing my eyes, and all of a sudden someone touched me. And when I opened my eyes, it was Father Capodanno. And he had been wounded pretty bad in his right hand, and he was quite bloody and dirty. But he got right down in my face, and with his good hand, I can remember him cupping the back of my head and he said, "Stay calm, Marine. There'll be someone here soon to help us, and that God is with us all here today." And Father, as soon as he said that, as soon as he put his hand behind my back of my head, a still came across me that I'd never witnessed before or since. There was no firing. There was no screaming. There was no war. It was. I had never experienced that before or since.
And Father Capodanno just got up, and after he blessed me, and he got up and he ran over to Doc Leal. And it was in behind Doc Leal supporting him when that same machine gun that I was supposed to take out opened up and killed both of them. And that's the last time I saw Father Capodanno.
As Father was finishing his blessing of Ray Harton, he heard the cry for help from Corpsman Leal and rushed to help him. He placed his body as a shield for Leal and immediately received the full blast from the nearby Viet machine gun. He died instantly with 27 bullets in his body.
The thing that got him was apparently he was moving towards a number of wounded Marines, and in their midst was a Navy corpsman named Leal. Leal was ministering to them, and so he was heading in their direction, and out of the corner of his eye, he saw a North Vietnamese soldier setting up his machine gun to fire at them. And this motivated him, it really propelled him towards these wounded troops, and he threw his body over them. Now, there are different stories as whether he was praying with them or whatever, but he deliberately blocked the vision of the NVA machine gunner. This man deliberately shielded these troops and gave his life for their sake, emulating the person of Jesus.
The next day, one of my duties as S2 was to gather the intelligence, and I was to go out, and I had to go out and go through the bodies, go through the remains, the North Vietnamese remains, and it was quite unusual because in almost every instance, they never left their dead there. They always took their dead with them or buried their dead. Mm-hmm. In this case, the battle was so intense during the night that when they pulled back, they just left their dead. Mm-hmm. And it was going out and having to do that. And then when I'd finished gathering all the, you can look at their uniforms and find the nomenclature, what outfit they're with, so that we could send that back to battalion and division to identify exactly what the division was that we were engaged with. So I was looking for Father, and I asked where he was, and the fellow said, "He's over there." And I said, I can't find him. Where is he? And he said, "He's over there." And when I asked him the third time, then he told me that he was dead, and I could see his arm out. He was under the poncho, and I saw his arm, and his left arm and his part of his arm was blown away. You know, we had taken a lot of casualties, and we'd taken a lot of KIAs, but there was just a pall over the whole company because of Father being gone. It was like the heart and soul of the company was cut out.
But when we got word of his death, it was as if a shroud had covered that entire battalion, especially in context of what he did and the word that was passed about his heroism, but even more so, his emulation of Jesus. Mm-hmm. He sacrificed his life for someone else because he loved others. The first thing I noticed about him was his eyes. His eyes were deep, they were knowing, they were compassionate, they were sad. Those eyes had seen too much suffering. He carried the weight of the world in those eyes. If I were to picture the eyes of Jesus Christ, they would be Capodanno's eyes. It told everything about the man. Capodanno was essentially a saint. He lived the life of a saint and he died a saint. And he emulated the person of Jesus Christ as much as anyone I've ever known, perhaps more so. He truly believed in Jesus. He lived the basic tenets of Jesus. He loved everyone he met, irrespective of their religion, their race, whatever. This man was an ambassador, a true ambassador, a living enactment of Jesus Christ. He was a saint, a living saint. He died a saint. And I would hope, I really would. He deserves this. He deserves to be beatified, and I think he needs to be seriously be considered for sainthood.
I thought sainthood would be a step down for the guy. I just thought he was an angel. Mm-hmm. I truly believe that angels move amongst us.
Father Cappadano had the courage of a lion and the faith of a martyr.
Father Vincent's a saint. He gave his life trying to save a Marine, a corpsman actually, Corporal Leal, who was wounded. He ran over to try to help this guy, and he got hit 27 times. He lived the Christian life that he professed to everybody else, to the death. He loved us, mm-hmm. to the death. I've never seen a greater act of Christian love than that. Mm-hmm. What more can you do than lay down your life mm-hmm. for your friends? Mm-hmm. That's what he did.
And there are young kids who are now adults who are fathers and even grandfathers who still talk about this man. Mm-hmm. They're still talking about him.
Great.
He made that much of an impact on their lives.
I think it was his eyes that that a lot of the young Marines remember him for. He had piercing eyes. He didn't demand your attention from his actions or his words. He demanded it through his eyes, the way he looked at you. And that's what I think we remember a lot of Father Cappadano for.
Who and what he was, basically a Christian, very simply, profoundly a Christian. And he ignited them. Changed a lot of lives.
He changed my life. I was away from church probably for about 18 years, I told you before. Yeah. And I'm back to church now, and I'll stay back.
Finest chaplain I ever knew. I mean, that's the way I would, I mean, he loved his men, he loved the battalion. I loved them. I cared about them. Every man in the battalion cared about them. And I'd say in the regiment. I shouldn't just say the battalion, not my battalion, because it was really the whole regiment. He was the Catholic chaplain for the 5th Marine Regiment. And he was he just walked, as far as we were concerned, he could do no wrong. He was walked on water. He was perfect.
We just felt terrible that he died, that he was killed the way he was killed. I mean, I would have been glad to die in his place. The truth is, though, I would have had to stand in line to do it. There were a load of guys who would have been willing to die for that priest. And not many people can say that. I mean, there are not many people you'd be willing to die for.
That's right, yeah.
But he was one. I wouldn't say everybody in the battalion would have been willing to die for him, but a number of guys would have. I know personally that they would have.
Good.
And I would have too.
Fine.
He was a better guy than I was.
These very laudatory statements by his fellow officers and men are like a beautiful requiem for Father Cappadano. But he is immortalized by his last words, his blessing of a wounded grunt.
Stay calm, Marine. There'll be someone here soon to help us. God is with us all here today.
We're delighted to have with us Father Daniel Mood, who is the author of the book from which, of course, we made the documentary. And so, Father, we're very glad to have you with us today.
Thank you, Archbishop, for having me.
Would you please tell us how you got into this?
About 15 years ago, I wanted to write a master's thesis for my history degree and my master's degree, and I thought Father Cappadano would be a great subject. He's so famous, Medal of Honor winner, ships named after him, and so forth. Doing the research, I realized not a whole lot was written on him. And it became a labor of love for me to discover about this very special and holy man, not only a military chaplain, but what I came to believe, maybe a saint.
By the way, give us your military background, too.
Well, I grew up in the military as a dependent. My father was a Navy captain. I have a brother who's a submarine officer. And then I'm a chaplain in the Navy.
Great. A reserve chaplain.
A reserve chaplain.
Fine, good. Now, tell us, too, what has happened since you wrote this book, because we have had
a tremendous response.
It has been overwhelming, and it was even before I wrote the book, or before the book was published, before my master's thesis was published. Mm-hmm. You know, I decided to end my book with this little story. It was about a man who, a week after Father Cappadona was killed, was totally affected by his story. Actually, he knew Father Cappadona, and he taught with him in high school when Father Cappadona was a seminarian. And he had fallen away from the faith. Mm-hmm. And the story reawakened his heart to come back to God. And he found himself in a church a week after his death. Mm-hmm. And while they were in the church, a priest came up to him and asked him who he was and where he's from. And he told him that he had known Father Cappadona, and it was time for him to get back to his faith because of Father Cappadona's inspiring life and story. And then he simply said, I guess a missionary doesn't stop working even after his death, does he? And since in the last 15 years, in the 4 years that the book has been published, I've had one story like that after another. Over 200 kind of accounts mm-hmm. and sometimes miraculous stories have been told to me.
But besides that, you've had a number of people call in saying that they have been... their cures and so forth and so on.
Absolutely. And the most striking one happened right around 9/11, when our country was going through so much on the terrorism attack. There was a lieutenant in New York, his name is Vincent, whose child was dying. He was very distraught, not only of 9/11, but of his own child dying of a rare blood disease. Somebody gave him courage, gave him a copy of the book, and he said, I need to rely on my faith. He brought his child to Father Cappadona's grave, laid his child on the grave, and after a year and a half of his child suffering from this rare blood disease that no doctor could cure, he was instantly cured. And a missionary does not stop working even after
he dies. That's right. Now, that means, too, that the prayers of all of these people have been answered, even those who are on the show, because they've said they would like very much to see Father beatified.
There are so many who have requested, thousands have said, when are you going to start the cause? When is it going to happen? So pray God.
That's right.
It will begin.
Focus would like to ask all our viewers to join us in prayer for Father Daniel Mode, who is serving in Afghanistan, as well as our entire military that so bravely serve our great nation.
To order a copy of this show or any other Focus production, call 504-840-9898 or 985-635-0333 or visit us on the web at FocusTVOnline.com. Focus would like to thank you for your kind donations. Your gifts and generosity make an immediate difference in the lives of many through these Focus programs. It's your contributions, however small, that make this show possible.